بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وعليمنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين الحمد لله حق حمده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إنما المشركون نجس فلا يقربوا المسجد الحرام بعد عامهم هذا إلى آخر آية صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق رسول النبي الحبيب الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والذاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين أيها الأحبة في الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته All praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord, nourisher, sustainer of all the worlds, and choicest blessings and salutations on the cream of creation, the reason of creation, Sayyiduna Muhammadin Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, his household, and all those that will follow him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with all of them and all of us, insha'Allah. Insha'Allah, it is the day of Jumuah, and it is the day, as recorded in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the day that our salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is presented to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, for the purpose of barakah, insha'Allah, let's all take 1 minute, insha'Allah, to send salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu ala Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 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 sallallahu ala Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day we were sitting with one of our teachers, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him a high place in Jannah, insha'Allah. And we were sitting, and as the format was, he would read Quran to us, and thereafter we would engage and be taught on the tafsir, sabab al-nuzul, of the ayah and of the surah, etc. But just for interest's sake, this was no ordinary teacher. And when I mean it, I mean it in the sense that part of his awrad, part of his daily practice, was that he completed 1 Quran khatam every day. Subhanallah. And this I have witnessed with my own eyes, and many of my fellow students have witnessed this. So he used to recite 1 Quran khatam every day. And we were sitting with him, and he was reading Quran, and we were following in the Mus'haf. And he came to a specific ayah, and he made a mistake. And as students, we looked at each other and we looked up and said, hey, Sheikh made a mistake. Like, what do we do? And we're looking at each other. No one wants to rectify him. And eventually we all just looked down and he carried on. Thereafter, he stopped himself and he asked us, you know, I made a mistake. So we said, nah, Sheikh, we know you made a mistake. So he asked us, so why didn't you rectify me? And you know, we were smiling, and we said, no, out of adab, Sheikh recites every day, who are we to rectify, and what do we know? And he said, okay. But he said, and he taught us something that day, and he told us that the haq is always the haq. And whether you are someone that recites the Quran every day, or whether you are alim, or whether you are someone that walks in the street, or doesn't know anything, the haq is the haq, and if someone does wrong, especially with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you need to rectify him. Obviously, you do it with hikmah and with wisdom and with mercy, but you need to rectify him. And in that same vein, this mimbar that I stand in is not the mimbar of the committee, nor is it the mimbar of the imam, nor is it my mimbar. But this mimbar has a haqq, for this mimbar belongs and this mihrab belongs to none other than Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This institution is his mihrab, and it has a haqq that goes with it. It is not here for us to preach and to gain popularity and to gain likes on Facebook or on YouTube. How many views? No. It is an amana from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is amana from that Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that cared and loved and gave everything for this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for his ummah. For we know that he used to stand up in Salatul Tahajjud, as recorded, until his feet was swollen. And he used to make dua, Rabbi habli ummati, Rabbi habli ummati. He used to cry for us, for this ummah. And it is recorded that one day he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting with his sahaba, and he was weeping and he was saying, I long to see my ihwan. I long to see my brothers. And then sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, are we not your ihwan? And he said, no, you are my ashab. And he said, my ihwan are those that have come and will come after me, that have not seen me, but they believe in me. Alhamdulillah, a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we are of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If there is anything else that we should be grateful for, or the most important thing we should be grateful for, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is that Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whose love for this ummah, as described in the hadith, that on that day when the trumpet is blown and the world is destroyed and we are gathered and we are on the day of Qiyamah and people are running from Anbiya to Anbiya, and we all know the story, we'll run to Nabi Adam and he'll say, Ya Rabbi, Nafsi, Nafsi, go to Ibrahim, go to Musa, go to Nuh. And it is on that day that we will come and they will say, go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we will go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he will not say, Ya Rabbi, Nafsi, Nafsi, he will say, Ya Rabbi, Ummati, Ummati, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. He is that Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that loved this ummah so much that on that day of Yawmul Qiyamah, everybody will be trembling, the sun will be close, it will be hot. You know, we know that when we write exams, we have that anxiety before we walk into the examination. It will be that multiplied on the day of Qiyamah. For Hisab has not started yet, and everybody's sweating, everybody's trembling. And we will go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and say, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ask your Lord to start the Hisab. We cannot handle this anymore. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is said that he will prostrate and make sujood at the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will say, Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi Ummati. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Ya Muhammad, irfa' ra'sak. O Muhammad, lift up your head. Washfa' tushaffa. And make shifa' and you ask, what do you want, Ya Muhammad? And he said, Ya Allah, hisab, hisab. And the hisab will start by the karama of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by the ikram of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But does it stop there, Jama'atul Muslimin? No. And thereafter, after hisab, those that love him and those that will be accepted will be gathered at the hawd of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is said there that there will be many cups, and people will be able to drink from the cups. But those that love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will drink from his blessed hand sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And do we think that is it? No. Thereafter we will go to Sirat. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be there. And he will be there making dua for us. Oh Allah, grant him ease over the Sirat. Oh Allah, my ummah, ya Rabbi ummati, ummati. And he will be granted ease for those that love him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and love this ummah sallallahu. And then thereafter it does not stop. Those that have been granted the passage to Jannah, they will go to Jannah. And when they get to Jannah, the doors will be closed And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will come and he will knock on the door and he will say, Assalamu alaykum. And Rizwanu, the angel of Jannah, will say, Wa alaykum as-salam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, open the doors and they'll ask, who is this saying? And he says, Ana Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rizwanu will say, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have not been ordered to open these doors for anyone except you sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they will open the doors and those that have been granted Jannah will enter Jannah. And does it stop there? No, Jama'atul Muslimin. For then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will leave Jannah and he will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he will say, Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi Ummati, Ya Rabbi Ummati. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say again, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ishfa'a tu sha'fa. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go to Nar and he will make dua and ask for those to be removed from the fire. This is the love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had and has and will always have for this ummah. But we need to ask ourselves, Jama'atul Muslimin, where is the love that we have for this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Alhamdulillah, we know it is the time when many of our brothers and sisters and friends are leaving for the lands and going for Hajj and Umrah. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take them and bring them back safely, Jama'atul Muslimin. But we need to be realistic and we need to understand Hajj in this world and in this time today, Jama'atul Muslimin. For Hajj today is not the Hajj that was preached to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For it has been disgraced by those that call themselves and those that call themselves custodians of the Haramain Sharifain. For in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and in any other time, no Muslim would be differentiated upon except as the ayah says, except by taqwa Allah. A black Muslim or a black person is not better than a white person, nor is a learned person better than an unlearned person, nor is a rich person better than a poor person, except by their belief and the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you look at the institution today, just go to the airport and you will see that someone with a British passport, or someone with an American passport, or someone that is fair-skinned and blue-eyed, gets preferential treatment at customs, get preferential treatment at Jeddah, as opposed to someone that comes from Bangladesh, someone that comes from Pakistan, that gets treated like dirt, Jama'atul Muslimin. This is the condition of the ummah today. Where is this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it is clear and there is factual proof? And if you ask me, I can give you the references, inshaAllah, that the land of Hijaz has been usurped from this Muslim ummah. That the land of Saudi Arabia, as we would like to call it, its economy today, Jama'atul Muslimin, is not run by oil. It is run by tourism. From our Hajj and our Umrah money, our hard-earned money that we save up all these years to go. And what do they do with that money, Jama'atul Muslimin? And it is recorded that in the news last week that £4 billion was spent on buying arms from Saudi Arabia. To do what? To slaughter and kill our brothers and our Muslim brothers and sisters in Yemen. No, it wasn't used to send to Philistine where they are needed, or to send to Burma where they are persecuted, or to send to China where the Muslims today, Jama'atul Muslimin, are being put in concentration camps. We just finished the month of Ramadan. And for many of us that do not know, in China, the Muslims were force-fed to break their fast. They were force-fed. They were not allowed to go to Salat al-Tarawih. They were told that they could not fast. They could not pray. This is the condition in China. And then we have the person that considers himself the custodian of Makkah and Medina. He goes to China. And we all know about MBS. He goes to China and tells the president of prime minister, it's okay, you can do to the Muslims what you will, it is your right. This is the haqq of this ummah today, Jama'atul Muslimin. And then we ask ourselves, why do we find ourselves in the situation that we are in? And as one of my teachers says, and this is a message not from me, but from one of my teachers and his teachers, that the biggest problem today within the Islamic Ummah is from within this Ummah. It is not from outside this Ummah, it is from within this Ummah. And we cannot expect change unless we try and change ourselves. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Ar-Ra'd, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, I think it is Ayah 11, Sheikh can rectify me, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَلِيمُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not change our condition unless we try and change it within ourselves, within this Ummah, Jama'atul Muslimin. This is the Ummah today. And it is sad that certain people, when they go for Hajj, and I'm talking about our brothers from the subcontinent, they do not have meals, they do not have anything, they sleep outside. But yet, other people can afford and they can purchase a 5-star Hajj, a 6-star Hajj, a 7-star Hajj. And this is fact. This is the condition that we find ourselves in today, Jama'atul Muslimin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala liberate all those brothers and sisters that are suffering all over the world, inshaAllah. And may we be a cause to help them in their liberation, inshaAllah. This is the plea that I make to myself and to the Jama'ah today, inshaAllah. For verily, this Ummah is in need of Rahmah. We are in need of that Rahmah that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showed not only to Muslims, but he showed Rahmah to everyone else. And it is sad that we do not have this Rahmah for each other, Jama'atul Muslimin. We are too busy fighting each other, and I saw a small video on WhatsApp, and it sums up the Ummah today. You see two gazelles fighting with each other, and around them you see different lions just watching them. And truly, this is the condition of this Ummah. We are too busy fighting each other today, while those that do not want this Ummah to succeed are just watching for us to kill each other, and then afterwards they will come and feast. For we are too busy fighting with one another. Oh, I am Shafi, you are Hanafi. I am Tablighi, you are Sufi. I am Wahhabi, you are Shi'i. You are Sunni, you are Shi'i. This and the other. But yet, when the illegitimate state of Israel, when they go into Gaza and they bomb, they do not ask and send out a form. Please stick if you're Hanafi and we won't bomb you. Or please stick if you're Shafi and send it back. No! They slaughter our brothers and sisters wholesale. They do not care. Irrespective of madhab, irrespective of aqidah, they kill Muslim. That's it. But yet we cannot see in each other that we are all Muslim. That we are all say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that should be enough. Not only should it be enough for this Ummah, but that should be enough for a visa for us to visit the Holy Lands. Why should we apply for a visa? The only visa that we need as Muslims is the visa of Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And this is where we find ourselves today, Jama'atul Muslimin. And we need to truly look at ourselves. We need to truly look within ourselves. For if we cannot change our condition, how can we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And yes, to make dua is one thing, but we need to be a practical ummah. We must not become a reactive ummah. For today we are a reactive ummah. When they start bombing in Palestine, then we want to go and march, then we want to go and protest. But before that, we do nothing. And on that matter, and as much as I have a great love for the land of Palestine, I ask you a question. How many protests or march have we seen for our brothers in Yemen? It's an open question. Ask yourselves that question. And it is recorded. Forget about adults now. It is recorded, and you can go and research, that 85,000 children have died in Yemen. Not from bombs or not from bullets. They have died from starvation, Jama'atul Muslimin. Died from starvation. We just need to think about that. And yet, the Saudi and the Arab United Arab Emirates coalition have spent 4.6 billion pounds, that is only with the UK, on arms. They have also signed a $4 billion deal with Trump when he was there for arms. Not to help this ummah, but to destroy our brothers and sisters. This is the condition we find ourselves in. And this is the haqq of this mimbar. For this mimbar, the institution of Jumu'ah and the institution of Hajj as well, was there to inform the community, the ummah, about what is happening within the ummah. So much so that one of my teachers used to explain the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that for someone that misses three Jumu'ahs, he needs to reinstate his shahada. Right? We all know that ruling. But he explained it to us so beautifully, and he said, not for any other reason except that after three Jumu'ah, that person would find himself so much removed from this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he would need to reinstate himself to this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Jumu'ah today is different to Jumu'ah as it used to be. For Jumu'ah and Hajj is supposed to be there, it is supposed to reignite and waken up this ummah. But the sad state is that Jumu'ah is a place where we come and we get a good 15-minute nap, a power nap we get during Jumu'ah, we nod off. But Jumu'ah is not supposed to be a madrasa lesson. We are not supposed to learn about salah and wudu. Yes, reminder is good, but we can go and read about it. We have madaris for that. But the institution of Jumu'ah was here to waken up this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this ummah, Jama'atul Muslimin, and I end off, that this ummah is crying, Jama'atul Muslimin. This ummah is crying. Aina ummatu Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Where is the ummah? Aina Salahuddin? Alhamdulillah, I'm not talking about Sheikh Salahuddin over here. But aina Salahuddin? Salahuddin ala Ayyubi? Where are those? And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the strength of Salahuddin, inshallah, so that we may liberate our brothers and sisters who are suffering from oppression. This ummah cries and yearns for us, Jama'atul Muslimin. And we get those people that say, oh no, we cannot do anything, we are waiting for Imam Mahdi, Imam Mahdi will sort everything else. One day someone came to one of our teachers and he asked, you know, Sheikh, where is Imam Mahdi? Where is Imam Mahdi? And he looked at him and he said, you are Imam Mahdi. And this person was confused, and I myself was confused. And he explained to us, within you is that ability of being Imam Mahdi. Because what if Imam Mahdi comes today? Do you think he would want a lazy person in his army? Someone that could not benefit this ummah? Do you think he'd want you to be part of him? So we need to become smaller Imam Mahdis within ourselves, within our communities, within our masajid. And inshallah, that will impact on this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I end off, inshallah, with a story that is well known. It is the story of Abdullah ibn Mubarak. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak, for many of us do not know, he used to do three things within his lifetime. He used to spread his years into three things. First thing was jihad. Next thing was learning for the learning in deen, ilm. I will not say deen, but ilm. And the third part, he used to go for Hajj. So he completed the first two, and he was about to go for Hajj. And he gathered all his students and everything, and they were ready, and they were going for Hajj. And those days, there was no plane or anything like that. They used to go by horse, or sometimes even walk or boat. And he goes for Hajj, and he stops because he comes across a family, and he sees a lady, and she is scratching in the dust. And she picks up something, you know, what we call roadkill. Something that has died, and she picks it up and she takes it home, and he follows her, and she cooks it, and she's about to give it to her children, and he says, oh my sister, you cannot feed your children with that because it is haram. And she turns around and she looks at him, oh Imam, it is haram for you, it is not haram for me, because my husband died, I have nothing, and my children are hungry, I have to feed them. What did Sheikh Abdullah ibn Mubarak do? He told his congregation, you proceed and go, I am going to stay. He took whatever he had and he made sure that his lady was taken care of. He made sure that he had food, provisions, he gave her money, and he did not go for Hajj. And then upon the completion of the Hajj, his students were coming back And he walked out to greet him. And he walked out and he said, Hajj Maqbool. And they looked at him confused and they said, Ya Shaykh, why are you greeting us? You were on Arafah, you made dua for us. You were at the roda of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you prayed for us. And he was very confused. And at night, he went to sleep. And he asked Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and he went to sleep for guidance. And Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came in his dream. And we all know that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if you see me in your dream, it is as if you have seen me haqqan, because shaitan cannot take my form. So Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came in his dream, and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he asked Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what are they talking about, what has happened? And Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, because of your concern for this woman, and because of your concern for this, for her condition, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala sent an angel in your place to perform all your rites of Hajj. Allahu Akbar. So we need to honestly look within ourselves and ask ourselves, if we know that our hard-earned money that we are going to use for the purpose of ibadah is subsequently being used to slaughter our brothers and sisters, then how are we going to answer to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala? And this is something that we really need to think about, Jama'atul Muslimin, and our ulama really need to think about it. Because we have evolved in what has become a selfish ummah. An ummah where we only care about ourselves. We are only worried about our deeds. We are only worried about us. But Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's ultimate concern was not for himself, but for his ummah. And where is our concern for this ummah? We pray that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala grant us the ability to care more for this ummah. And we pray that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala not only liberates Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, but Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala liberates the Haramain Sharifain from the usurpers that have taken it from this ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I pray that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala forgive me and bless you. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينُ. Jazakumullah.